to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, item 4.04, adoption of the agenda.
Madam Chair, I move adoption of the agenda with the removal of item 8.02 and item 8.03.
Is there a second?
Mr. Rasnick, I discussed that item. We're going to have an update, I believe, from the chairman as to our discussion in work session. So right. That would remain on.
Right. Thank you. Second.
Second.
All right. All in favor of that motion?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Item 4.05, oath of office for a gifted and talented student advisory committee member. Do we have a student advisory committee member here? Very good. Please come forward. Greg, you're our gifted and talented liaison. Would you please join our student member?
Absolutely.
I think you can do it there. So she had an in.
Do you, Maeve Curtin, solemnly affirm that you will support the mission of the Falls Church City Public Schools, endeavor to serve all students in your decisions and actions, and faithfully and impartially discharge and perform the duties incumbent upon you as a member of the Gifted and Talented Advisory Committee according to the best of your ability, so help you God. Congratulations.
Congratulations and welcome. Thank you, Mr. Rasnick. All right, moving along to public comments and requests. Do we have any slips for public comment this evening?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am. And do we have any other letters or materials?
We do. The board did receive a letter from Barbara Neuter, basically offering, asking the board to review her qualifications for an interim appointment to the school board should the board decide to move in that direction.
Thank you, Mr. Kimball.
Madam Chair, I'll just mention that the board also had directed to it a letter from Cecily Shea. It was sent about a few minutes before 6 o'clock this evening. And
okay.
That, that's also been available to us.
Is it in here?
It's not in here yet.
No, I think it's in your email inbox, but it's not here yet. And if you would provide a copy of it to the clerk, that would be great. All right. Thank you. For that, Mr. Sharp. No recognition reports this evening. Moving along to item 7, which is the consent agenda.
Okay. Three items on the consent agenda this evening. Under personnel, a resignation that the board accept the following resignations. Dr. Juanita Briscoe, testing coordinator, Office of Curriculum Instruction and Assessment, effective January the 1st, 2012. And Dr. Dana Wiseman, George Mason High School philosophy teacher, effective January the 27th, 2012. Extra pay for extra duty assignment. The board approved one extracurricular activity EPD assignment, Mary Ellen Henderson, for the 2011-2012 school year. And the last item, updated 2011 to 2013 Falls Church City Public Schools comprehensive plan, that the board approve the updated 2011-2013 FCCPS comprehensive plan as presented.
Thank you very much. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move the consent agenda as presented.
Thank you. Second?
A second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right. That motion passes as well. I thought everybody must have been watching videos or something. All right. Very good. Now we move along to probably what many of our guests are here to witness this evening, and that is the superintendent's presentation of her recommendations for the budget.
First of all, let me say a formal good evening to the school board. And also, I do have several members of our senior leadership team. If they would just stand so we can recognize you, we're happy to have you with us tonight for the budget. Thank you very much. And also to members of our community. This year in our budget, we have three driving really priorities. There are three main priorities. First of all, staff compensation is going to be critical for us this year. Also, increasing student achievement and teacher tools. Obviously, we're in the school, we are in the business of schools. Student achievement is at the forefront of everything that we do. And we also want to work to maximize efficiency in all of our operations across the division. I'm going to brief you on four different areas. Discussion item one tonight is revenue and spending history. And I do think the board is very well versed in this, but there may be people in the community that may not be. The discussion item two is actually challenges and what are those key impacts and the drivers to our budget this year that are going to pose challenges for us. The discussion item three is focusing on what are the positives that are in our budget. What are the great things that we're doing inside of our budget this year that we're recommending to you tonight? And again, I really reinforce that these are recommendations, that this is not, and I just want to publicly say, this is not our budget until we spend almost 2 months talking about the budget. So all of these are recommendations. First of all, if we look at our revenue history and how we actually spend our money, this is very important this year in the state of Virginia, because if you're watching what's going on in Richmond, they're talking about legislation that would legislate a 65% rule for us to be spent on instruction. If you look at what we spend, we're already at 72%. We're very proud that the dollars we get are going to take care of our children and teaching and learning. We're putting that money back in the classroom. We also have 11% on facilities. Obviously, that's utilities and all of those added additions. This year, it included things like increased safety. You know, we've added the new entrances at all of our buildings to make sure that our doors are secure and they're locked. Administration is 6%. If you look nationally, you'll often see administration around 10%. So we're also doing excellent in that category. Technology, it's amazing what we're able to do with technology, and we're really focused on that this year, and we're only spending 4% of our budget. So we have a great technology team doing wonderful things. Transportation is 3%, 2% through transfers and reserves, and then also our health. If we look at our revenue sources, and this is a question that I am often asked is, well, how much money really comes from the city? Most of our money comes from the city transfer, 78%. And so it's quite a bit. The state funding will be at 8% this year, 6% in sales tax. We also have 1% in federal. That's the one that often really shocks people, because so much of what the federal government tells us we have to do really drives a lot of our decision making, and it's 1% of our budget. And I know that as we're working on the task force to reduce some of the paperwork, it won't affect that federal level, but at least reducing some at the state level this year could be great for us. We also have our historic revenue and operating budget, and it starts on the bottom with 09. And obviously, we've been in economic difficulties, and so if you follow up, you'll see that there's been a decline. And this year, of course, I think we all know we had a flat budget. But if you also look at the state funding, that's what this other number is, just so that you can get an idea. It's done the same thing. It's pretty much been going in reverse for us, and it will still be a challenge this year. When we look at, I decided to start with the things that are the scary things first. What are those challenges? So we can end on a more positive note tonight. We have some budget drivers that are really important for us. Salary step for all staff. state and federal loss of funding is right now, and again, this is based on a lot of the budget drivers are based on recommendations coming from the governor. We don't really know where we will end up, so tonight the recommendations are based on where we are as of today. Hiring additional staff, and you'll see that existing is underlined. We are not talking about projections. You know, we often get into a debate about what is our projected number, where are we? We're talking about children that are already in the seats right now, and VRS and fixed cost increases. First of all, to fund a step increase for our staff is $720,000, and you will have a printout of the PowerPoint once I finish as well. And yeah, if you'd like that beforehand, would you like for to take it? And this does include an increase for all staff. That was very important. You heard that from PEAK and EEK and SEEK. We have people who have been topped out on the scale for quite some time. And some of those people, I heard some wonderful stories where, you know, it's sad, but they've actually seen that reduction in their paycheck. We want to make sure that we're taking care of everybody. And so this budget does recommend an increase for everybody. And we have added an extra step. So those people who have been here for 20 years now have a 20-year step. If they've been here that long, they deserve a step. This year, we're also, one of our challenges is the cost of competing. And for people in the community that may not realize what that means to us, because we're in Northern Virginia, it's more expensive to live here. It's more expensive for teachers to work and to be here than it would be to be in a rural area. This year, the governor's recommendation has us showing a loss. We're losing our funding for our support cost of competing, and that amount is $99,800, and again, that's just more than a teacher, slightly more than a teacher. The other big driver this year is our federal stimulus, and you know, we have done a great job in this division. I commend you, because I wasn't here. We didn't spend our federal dollars to hire staff. And if you watch what's going on right now in the media across Virginia, there are huge cuts and salaries, people that are being let go because they spent their stimulus money for staff. However, $541,000 and 100 is a lot of money to us that was going towards instruction. So we will feel the impact, but we're very positive about how that money was spent. And we're looking forward in a positive way. Our five teachers, we know that we need at least five teachers, and that's $400,000. And we have gone into the budget literally line by line, so we really do know to the pinpoint what an average salary is costing us right now, and that's $80,000 with all of the benefits. So when we replace a teacher, we know that's what we need to budget for. Again, we saw the largest increase in enrollment this year, 4.5%, largest we've had in 30 years. So as the budget has gone down, obviously our enrollment has gone up. And I just think it's important, again, that we just take a look at just the last 4 years. I didn't go back 30 to look at the enrollment, but we keep increasing every year. And I think an important factor is what I have put right down on the bottom, and that's if we didn't hire staff, we would be absorbing more than 200 students without having added one teacher. We simply can't do that going into next year. These are our numbers, and again, I've got that word current in bold and underlined because this is different for us. We're not projecting. If we took the students that we have today and we put them in the grade level next year, that's exactly where we would be today. And what you'll notice is where you see a six, that means there's six teachers on that grade level. Where you see a seven, we have seven staff. So when the students move, you'll notice that what's happened is where we still have those sections of six. As of today, those classes would be 29. When we open it, that's without growth. And we have not experienced a year where we didn't have growth in 30 years. So we know that those numbers, these class sizes would be in the 30s. Now, one thing that you will notice is in secondary, we have about four sections, and I have briefed you on that this year, that are large, that is really by master schedule choice right now, and it's to make student schedules work. They could change and be in a class of 15 or 18, but to make their schedule more effective for the student, they've given some, we have some larger class sizes, about four. But you will notice right now, we're not recommending, unless the numbers increase, that we add a lot of staff in secondary, and partly that's because at the end of next year, 20% of that student population will move. The one thing we're being very cautious of, watching it very closely, is to make sure we don't overstaff. So at the end of the year, we have high school people who are not able to then transfer and be a middle school teacher. So we do not want to overstaff. VRS and our fixed cost increases are huge this year. VRS is just, and this is the increase, not the total amount, just over 1 million is the increase that we're seeing. For a large increase, traditionally in Virginia history, it would have been just over 300,000. So what we're seeing right now, and again, this is as of today, once they finish in Richmond, we'll find out where we really are, but it will be an increase of $1 million. That also increases our VRS group life, and that increase is right at about four and a half times what we expected that number to be. Health insurance, of course, increases every year. So if we look at, these are the drivers just all on one page that I've just talked about. We have our step increase, VRS retirement, VRS life, health insurance, hiring five teachers, and cost of competing. And that adds up to just over $2.6 million. So, and the interesting thing is when you really look at that list, there are not a lot of negotiables. We have to have teachers. And the salary step is critically important for our staff. And obviously VRS, and again, that's where we stand as of today, we have to pay those things. And that doesn't include stimulus. So if you added the loss of stimulus, you know, to be fair, that would have put us over $3 million. Now, what are the positives? So we're gonna look at the happy things. Inside our budget, we're working on these initiatives right now in FY12 with a flat budget. So again, our staff is doing a great job. Hybrid learning, and you'll notice it doesn't say e-learning or virtual learning, it says hybrid learning, and we're trying to really, we've talked about the vocabulary, because hybrid learning is what you're seeing if you read a lot of educational research right now, because we want a highly qualified teacher behind that computer and we want it to be our staff. That's the difference between hybrid and virtual. Doesn't mean that virtual can't be great, but we don't want to support our students just taking a class from Kentucky or Florida, and we don't really know who's behind it. We want to be in control of our hybrid learning program. And that was definitely going to be a huge benefit for credit recovery for our homebound students. We often have trouble, you know, getting tutors that can go out and work with children. Modified scheduling for students who need a slower or a faster pace, and also for summer school support. Digital access. I was just in a conversation today with some of the media specialists, and it was very exciting, just talking about ebooks. We want to make sure that we're continuing to grow in that technology aspect for media. We're also looking at our STEM support and making sure that we're, and some of us would put an A in there to add the arts into science, technology, engineering, and math. Assistive technology will remain a focus. We also want to make sure we continue to focus on technology tools for our staff. Digital automation is something that we started working on July 1. We're focused on that. We will be all through the year going into FY13, making sure, and we've already automated our applications this year, but of course that will show up in the budget as a line item. This year we had to find the money to do that. Purchase orders will be automated by the end of the year. We'll also, our sub-calling we've automated. So we're working on all of our systems so that it takes some relief off of our people at that central office level, which allows us to then fund other things. Digital assessment is another piece that we're really working on, is making sure that we are putting in assessments where we're getting more instant results that are correlated not only to Virginia standards, but what we're trying to put in right now also correlates to Common Core if Virginia should decide to move that direction. And it's also based on student growth and teacher-driven assessments. What are the things that are useful for them in really driving their instruction? And inside our budget, you will see changes in how we're going to purchase and what we will purchase for assessment. This is an assessment that we're trialing this year, and I just wanted to share it tonight as part of the budget because it's in the FY13. This is actually our math that we are trialing right now in first through eighth grade. when you look, this data, obviously there's no name on it. This data is okay data for all of us to see. But if this were a student, you would have your first test, your second test, and we can actually look at what is that percentile growth from the first time we tested the student to the second time. We can test with these assessments as many times as we want throughout the year. So if we have a student in remediation and we need to be testing every 5 weeks, we can do that. If we have students who we want to assess every quarter, we can do that. And right now, we're already implementing this, and the teachers are doing a great job in math. MEH is actually going to be implementing the reading component here within the next month because they want it. They want the data. And so you will see our testing and assessment starting to change in how we're spending our money this year in FY13. We also are funding some other things that we just want to make sure that you know are inside the budget. K-5 math books. They've been reviewing math books for the past 2 years, and they have made a decision on what they'd like to purchase. We're making sure that we use money from FY12, also FY13, to complete the purchase going into the 1st of September so they can start school with their new materials. MEH has some areas that need new science books. We need world language books. GM will be wireless by FY13. We're working very hard on that. MEH will have enhanced wireless so that we can add more computers throughout the building. Right now, there are a lot of dead spots there, which means that when you're trying to assess students on computers, if they lose their connection, they lose their test. Dual enrollment this summer, we're moving forward with FY12, going into FY13, making sure that that's part of our budget and funding dual enrollment. Continued funding of PYP IB testing, and we're just starting MYP just a little bit this year. We really want to wait until we go through our big realignment so that we're not training people in areas too soon where they don't need to be. We're also looking at a realignment of resources to maximize our efficiency, and this is one way that that $2.6 million does come down a little bit, and we feel great about it. We're trying to do our part and contribute and make sure that we're really operating efficiently. If you remember, at the beginning of FY12, we started by a natural attrition, so we're not cutting people's positions, but we're looking at every position as it opens up. In the FY12 budget, we were actually budgeted for all of those positions that are in yellow. After the year started, we were able to do a realignment. We've actually eliminated these two positions at the bottom and added the one over on the right for a systems engineer. While we have gone down one position, our systems engineer is fantastic, very, very high skill level. We've increased our efficiency, but we've reduced our cost. We've also done that in our high school, and this, I can't really take credit for it. This was Mr. Bird, because as we started to look for a 0.4 assistant principal, the candidates that we were looking at, we didn't feel like we were going to be able to actually get a candidate at 0.4 that was really committed to George Mason High School. What this alignment allowed us to do is, by adding a dean of students, it opened that position up for those people who are committed to George Mason. It gave us an opportunity to give somebody more of a leadership opportunity than they would have normally had, and it again had a cost savings for the division. Currently in our central office, this is what we look like. We have an assistant superintendent of curriculum instruction and assessment, over on the left-hand side, the assistant superintendent for finance and operations. And down on the bottom, we have four different departments. We are, as we, again, through natural attrition, we're not hurting people. We're doing this naturally through a very positive way. We are going to do some realignment and consolidation within our central office. And so you see the X's on there. This department, the director of personnel in that whole department, is actually merging into a new department. Again, the people who are working under this department are merging. We're adding the Office of Curriculum, Innovation, and Personnel, and we're eliminating all three of these. Now, we feel great about that. First of all, this position, Curriculum Innovation and Personnel, Lisa High is who I'll be recommending to you to step into that position in the central office. As most of our staff are all very aware, she has also been a principal, has a great background and experience to lead in a curriculum innovation setting, and I think the staff are going to be excited to know who's going to be in that position as we reorganize too. This is what the realignment of resources does for our staffing adjustments. It's a total savings for those three slides that you saw, $335,700 by realigning. And that's equivalent to 4.2 teachers. And that's where I always take it back to, because we want to really consolidate within our central office, upper administration, making sure we're creating an environment where we feel great about what we're doing at central office, but also supporting our teachers in the classroom and our students. I'm also recommending that we do a realignment of resources in our community services. And the use of fund balance, and I'll have another slide on that here in just a second, also recommending modernization for FCC TV. And I'll talk about that after I do this one. For our community service fund balance, we want to use part of that fund balance, $277,000, that we would like to budget. We're recommending for furniture and the permanent one-time expenses that we will need to do all of our shifting and setting up the new construction at TJ for new furniture. Now, we're actually, you know, in speaking with Mr. Kimball, we have used fund balance before, but usually what happens is, and the board probably doesn't always realize, because it's sitting there, and if we need, for instance, we had funded bleachers in the past, we just paid for it. But we wanted to be very open and transparent and say, we're really trying to look inside our own budget and make sure that we're taking care of ourselves as much as we can. And that $277,000 is going to be hugely important for us as we transition to the new construction. The modernization of FCC TV, what I'm recommending here is that we move from a cable-based to a web-based platform. I know the city, I've spoken with Mr. Shields as well. We highly value the public viewing of our meetings. We know that that's extremely important, but we also know that when we're trying to fund issues, and for me, it's about putting teachers in classrooms, I would be irresponsible if I didn't say that's my number one priority. And this is one area that I feel like we can really streamline, change our vision for what happens there, and still meet the needs of the community. We really want to go with live streaming for all devices so that we can open that door a little bit. If you have an iPad or you have an iPhone, then we don't have to worry as much about some people not being able to see the live streaming on the web. And just by changing our provider, we could do that with ease. We would also like to reduce expenses and equipment cost. What you need to upload and put for a cable channel is very different than what, you know, quite frankly, I can pull out my iPhone, video you, and upload it in a minute. So it's just very different equipment that we would need to have this vision. Again, same communication vision of live streaming of meetings and events. New enhanced access for our students. And this is probably key for me. If it's going to show up in our budget, how does it impact children? And if it's not impacting children, then we really have to step back and examine what we're doing. I see with a web-based system so much capability. Everything we're reading right now in STEM education, it talks about having a web-based system like this. And there's a great deal that we could do to really move it forward and impact students. I think many people in our community know our middle schoolers right now have a news show every single morning. When they go to high school, we lose that. This would be such an easy transition to really pull a great team of people together, not only our technicians, our STEM educators, as well as Mike Palmrose with FCC TV, and create a new vision that saves a little bit of money. And the total savings we could get there is $80,000, and again, that's another teacher. I just put a couple of things up here so that as you go through the budget, you'll be able to see that every time we had an increased expense, I've worked with Mr. Kimball, who is just brilliant and done a great job. We've tried to balance that out with where can we reduce? Do we have waste? Our IB assessments and registrations are increasing 10%. That's 14,000. TJ construction, we need to be budgeting right now for the utility expenses that we will see when the construction's taking place. We also have a central office rent increase that is in our contract every year. Then we've gone into the budget for things like reduction in advertising, postage, and printing. As you automate, a lot of those things start to go away. And so we're reducing there. We're also reducing in some of our professional services, trying to do more ourselves. Again, more efficient way to operate for us. We are continuing our focus on healthy meals for all children. We know that the school board and as a school division, we're very focused on this. We're funding our summer backpack lunch initiative. We don't know that that's the real name, but that's what we named it. Because, you know, we really have a problem with feeding children all year long, and then we know they go home for the summer, and it's like, well, okay, we care about them for these 9 months, but what happens in the summer? So we're making a commitment to make sure that that moves forward for summer this year. We are also, just to make sure everybody knows, with our budget consideration and transportation, we try to add a bus, and they've done a great job. I give Dr. Berlin and Mr. Kimball credit for making sure they're purchasing a bus every year. We're continuing that. The difficulty is now all of our buses are full right now. We're barely making it through this year. And the bus that we add will not be a replacement. We can't retire one of these 1999 buses. So we will be looking at that as we move forward. You know, is there a way for us to perhaps the next year add two buses? And so we've got our eye on that. So what is our actual budget request after all the positives? See, doesn't that feel better? We ended on the happy. When we look at the total proposed budget, the superintendent's budget with the city transfer, $29,903,800. And again, this first budget, you'll see it has a number one up here. It shows community services flat, and that represents a 7.3 increase. And $2,042,200. Now, I've put a budget one and a budget two because FCC TV is a tripartite agreement. I didn't want to assume that I had the authority to make that recommendation. That certainly, as a school board, you can support that recommendation. This is the budget that I support, but I wanted to be sure and show it both ways that in the transfer, we can reduce that community services by $80,000, which then leaves that money in operating for the city to actually fund whatever we need. So that reduces us to 7%. And again, that's really going inside, looking at everything that we can do. When we look at this, and I'm just trying to give you on the slide that had the greater increase where we don't reduce community services, this is what a city transfer of that amount funds. It funds our VRS retirement, VRS life, health, and five teachers. And that's what you get right there. There's no fluff or anything exciting in those numbers. And that leaves us with $175,500. So that means that we have that to apply to our step, which is about 24.5%. So we've gone inside our budget to find the other 75% to fund the step for our teachers with this request. And we've done it without hurting, because we're making sure that what we're doing, we're still going to run efficient and effective. But we're funding the things that we need. We've gone inside our budget to do that. So if we look at the city transfer, then again, this is on that budget number one, just giving you an idea of the percentages. City transfer at 7.3%. We'd have 1.4% of our budget for state. Federal, we have a loss of $500,000 in the federal. Other funding is that 34.2. Part of that is savings and cost savings that we have, as well as our carry forward. And the overall budget, if you look at the bottom, would be 5.3% increase. And again, we're losing some state revenue. Our state numbers should be higher than it is this year, and that again is posing another challenge. We are doing more with less, and I think it's really important that people understand we have great staff, we have great teachers in the classroom who are really working and doing more with less. And when you look at this graph, this is the per pupil spending. With this request, it may sound like it's a higher request, but we're nowhere near we were even in 09 or 10 in what we're spending on our students, because we have more children to educate. I always think it's great to look at it from the materials and supplies, because the reality is, in that slide you saw before, out of that 16,000, the vast majority of that goes to salaries and compensation. Very little really funds, and the rest of it pretty much is utilities and the other things that we need. Our materials and supplies, when you look at where we are, $485 per student. So if I'm a teacher, and little Johnny is sitting, my husband's name is John, so I can say that. Little Johnny's sitting in your class, every day you have about 35 cents to spend. So if you think of it that way, and we're asking our teachers to do hands-on lab experiments, we're asking them to do great projects with children, but when you really look at what a great job our staff are doing on a very small budget, they're doing some amazing things. Again, with our city appropriations, this shows it both ways, and you'll have this again on your PowerPoint with community services flat, also with the reduction. So we can, 7.3 would be a recommendation, or 7.0. And my recommendation would be the one in red, that we ask for a 7%. Now, what could change coming out of Richmond? And we're going to be watching this very closely, because again, I can't emphasize enough that this is recommended based on where we are today. And VRS, 1% change is $183,000. So if they decided to give us 2% back, that would be a big impact for us. VRS life, 0.1% is $21,500. Health insurance, 1% would be $19,600 we would gain back. And then that cost of competing. And I will say this, cost of competing is one that superintendent's organization is really very loud and strong. We may see that come back. We're hopeful, because some divisions are seeing $10 million. So for us, we're really hopeful, because again, that's a teacher. These are the dates for our future dates when we will be meeting, assuming that none of these change, which I don't think that we're planning on them right now. January 24th is our first public hearing. Again, these will be posted on the web. This is the web address, but if somebody doesn't have a pen to write it down, it's just fccps.org, and you will be able to find budget information, and we will keep updating that as we go through the budget, and for anybody that wants more information. Okay, thank you very much. Do you have any questions for me tonight?
Thank you, Dr. Jones. Fabulous presentation. We don't generally pose questions to the superintendent this evening. We're on a listening kind of mode tonight. On the 21st of January, which is our first budget work session, which will start around 8 o'clock at the central office, for those who are in the listening audience, you'll get plenty.
Great. Thank you.
Dr. Jones, that having been said, congratulations on presenting your first budget to the school board.
Thank you. All right, next item on the agenda. Oh, mine hasn't changed yet. I think the next item on the agenda, mine hasn't quite updated on my iPad for some reason. Would be an update to the community about the appointment of an interim member of the school board. We did have a work session earlier this evening where the board had lengthy conversation on this topic. And what we have decided to add an interim member of the school board. There was agreement that we would want this person to be on board, sworn in, and ready to participate by our January 21 budget work session, so that they could be fully engaged with us in that important topic. Tomorrow you will see announcements going out through the local media, as well as our school channels, the morning news, as well as our social media and the website and so on and so forth, informing the community about the process. I'm going to summarize it just real quickly, and that is, we would like for folks to send a letter indicating their interest by the 18th of the month. The school board will then collect those up at noontime on the 18th. The school board will collect those up, and we will meet the morning of the 19th at 7:30 a.m. to consider the applications that we have and to determine who we will appoint to join us on the board. We're going to try to get that person sworn in as quickly as possible so they can join us on the 21st in their full capacity as a board member. So watch this station, and you'll get more information. We did decide the kind of information we'd like to have from you, and the kind of qualifications we're looking for. All of that will be pushed out into the public. So if you have questions about that, you can contact either myself, anybody on the board, or certainly Marty Goodell, who will be kind of the collector of all the information for us. So that's why I've updated. Did I leave anything out or get anything wrong, colleagues? All right, very good. The next item on our agenda, back to Dr. Jones, will be the approval of the CIP budget recommendation to City Council. So, Dr. Jones.
Well, just as a reminder, we were going to talk about this in a work session, and so it is very much in draft mode, and I am looking for the feedback from you tonight. When we look at the CIP, as you know, we were asked by City Council to do a review of our properties, look at the Mount Daniel solution, originally with the Dewberry study that was around a $17.5 million redesign there. So we've done all of that work, and this is our first meeting since we've really talked about what those results were, but January 17th is the deadline for the city, so we're trying to get to that point tonight. When you look at this for FY13, we need to complete the work that we have started at Thomas Jefferson, and that had been planned to be in the budget for FY13. It also has, down in the bottom, some systems replacements, and again, you'll see the addendums that are behind here that give you a little bit more information about what, you know, what those are for. FY14, moving forward with CDC, that Cherry Street property, that would be requesting the $2 million. So that we can, and you'll notice it says renovation and or construction, because the assessment that we have done on that property is very, very small. It was a gratis assessment by the firm that we're working with Thomas Jefferson. And so we know that it may be more cost effective to actually knock that building down and rebuild for the same amount of money, depending on the amount of renovation that has to go into that building. So we've built in $2 million there for the Cherry Street property. In FY15, this is the Mount Daniel expansion that includes the ADA renovations. And that number, when I went back and pulled the plans, I also communicated again with Arcadis and asked for an update as was requested by the board to expand another 5,000 square feet for the cafeteria and the gym area, so that we could bump that out in the front on top of that 4A. So we now have a 4B, but you will notice that the drawing is not there because I didn't want us to pay just for them to redraw. Just they were giving me a good solid number. And then FY16 and FY17 are the two that are probably, I've put these in the CIP. It's $40 million each year and for us to go in and actually build a high school. And if you wonder where does that number come from, it's based on 220,000 square feet. And then we've gone in and I'm looking between 1,200 and 1,500 students and X amount of square footage per student. So I've put that on the CIP. And that's where I think we probably would have the most discussion. I think Cherry Street property, expansion of Mount Daniel. I felt like I had great feedback coming out of our work session where we made those adjustments to the plans. Down on the bottom, the systems replacement. Some of these items would go away if the George Mason were FY16, FY17, because a lot of that is George Mason that needs the update. So, but I felt this was on the CIP last year. I felt it needed to reappear. It wasn't fully funded last year, and that's why it's all still in bold. Then you'll also see on the second page, these were just, and again, these are putting these things out there to make sure that they're on our radar. The baseball soccer field for some lights. We do have, I know that the school board heard about our, you know, game last year. We do have community support for funding, and they're working very hard. If there was a way to have $110,000 to help the community, we could make that happen faster. They're willing to contribute quite a bit and work very hard on that behalf. Also, the track resurfacing. If you haven't looked at our track lately, that's something that is going to have to be done. It's not going to be safe for children to run on. Then the thing that's behind that is the football soccer field turf replacement. And again, this I've also communicated, obviously, with Sevi Padilla, who does ours, but we've been communicating with the city. This more than likely is showing up in the city CIP as well to make sure that we're on the same page and figuring out how that would actually be funded. But it's on the CIP because it needs to, it's going to be at the end of its life. So that is what is in a $94,912,640 CIP budget.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Jones. Are there questions from any of my colleagues on the board? Mr. Rasney.
Yeah, I just have one question. Was there, in terms of the, obviously, the big item, FY16, 17. Was there any discussion with city staff in terms of
And as a matter of fact, I had a discussion with the city today on this issue, and I reminded them that they had asked for us to expedite and try to get to this point by redesigning, looking at what we have. And I felt like, you know, we didn't have a meeting before tonight. And so, you know, I expressed to them, that's why it says draft all over it. And I'm asking for feedback on what you want me to present to city council. It's on here because it's been on our radar and we were asked to look at all our facilities. So the discussion that I had today was we're in draft mode. The school board hasn't even discussed it. So I would start with the school board before I would start with the city staff about what you want.
Anything else? Rizar?
No.
Any questions? Ms. Wodisca?
I just want to make one comment. It's what's $90 million. They should have, you know, they should have signed on when we said $50 million. But they didn't. Yeah. That's a lot more.
Dr. Jones, I want to compliment you. I think this is incredibly thoughtful. I appreciate the way that it's been presented. I know this is a different design for us. It's very digestible. I think it's easy for the public to follow along. And I very much appreciate the footnotes and the additional drawings to kind of help visualize where we're headed, the additional information about even square footage costs. That type of detail is incredibly helpful. So I know that we've had a couple conversations about this leading up to this point, and really want to give you and your staff due compliments on your due diligence. A tremendous amount of thought and homework has gone into this presentation to get to this point. And so even if our conversation is brief this evening from the dais, I don't want that to suggest that there hasn't been so many hours.
Right.
And I really, really feel very good with what you've put forward, so thank you.
Thank you. Any questions on this end?
No, I guess the main thing is the high school construction. Okay. It's huge. We know it, and it's unavoidable. I think we have to really track that, you know, very carefully. I love the square footage cost there. I think that's really, really helpful, because I think this this shows what we have to look forward to, and we really do have to plan. It just can't be ignored anymore, so it's really necessary, and I appreciate that especially. But the whole document is great, so thank you.
Mr. Sharp, do you have questions or comments? He smiles, of course he does.
Yeah, Dr. Jones, I'm very impressed by certainly the earlier budget presentation and this as well. Thank you. I know this is very different than what we're used to, as John said, but a refreshing presentation and really, really well done. I do have some feedback from a brief meeting. It was over an hour, but it was trying to cover several topics with just a few people who I asked to come and help me to understand some of the feelings that the community was having about some decisions that we were going to face very soon after the holidays. And I didn't feel like we had a lot of opportunity to consult among ourselves or with the public, or even in some cases to know what the circumstances were going to be. The governor's budget was certainly one of those. The changes in the city's finances, I think, is another one where we had a 4-month report, and then now we have a 5-month report, and you can draw some trends from those I think some tentative character to them. At the same time, I think the trends are very positive that we're seeing, and so I see what you've done as really a conservative placement of where we could be with the budget. I know when I had the one-page presentation that Hunter initially gave to us back in December, that showed the expense items that we were likely to face, including the STEP and the VRS, and the VRS at that time was only a third of what, in terms of increase, as to what we're facing. The add up of those things that we saw back in December was suggesting more like a 9% increase without the benefit of the governor's proposal coming in here. I think the wizardry, if you will, or whatever you might want to call it, that you showed us in the way that you've reorganized things, but still being able to pull effectiveness and efficiency out of it is just spectacular. The capital improvement, another piece of the feedback that I had from the community was, gee, this sheet of information, it really doesn't show us capital needs. And there are, it was obviously operating budget items, but they said to me, one of the big things we're facing is huge changes in enrollment and aging facilities. And the combination of those two things adds up to big capital needs in the future. And they're not really reflected here. How do we get at that? So one of the questions I have about this is, these are top line numbers of how much it would cost for each of the things that we might do in the facilities area. But there's also, I think, a question of further down from the top line, things like what does this do to the debt service? And the council, as you know, also sort of changed the game right before the end of the year by calling for an increase in capital reserves to help with debt service. Okay, well, how does their putting this new wrinkle in the game, how does that affect what the numbers that we're looking at here in the debt service? Is there a debt service now plus some contribution to a capital reserve? It's not just the ongoing debt service, but it's debt service plus. And all of that, the debt service, the reserve things that we're seeing from the council, those things, while they suggest that they're only having impact on facilities, that area, really on an annual basis, they have an impact of removing resources from the base of resources that we'd otherwise tap for our operating expenses. And also for not just operating expenses on the city and the school side, but there's also the question of on an ongoing basis, what's the tax rate gonna be? That's all has to be factored in there on an annual basis. If the anticipated idea, at least with last year's rather large jump in the tax rate, was that would be a temporary phenomenon, then I don't know that we should be counting on a sort of a steady line tax rate going forward and what the revenue is that would produce. Maybe we have to have a different assumption. And how does that different line factor into this five-year plan? And then there's just the facilities implications themselves here. Certainly the 16 and 17 year is a great vision, and yes, I can understand spending $350 per square foot on a revised building. At the same time, even in the shorter run, as you indicated, we only know a little bit based on a gratis review of Cherry Street, what that change there could mean. And so, the vision is not is not terribly clear, and it's certainly not your fault, and it's not our fault, but even in the short run, the vision is blurry. And so I draft is a the letters aren't big enough for the draft emphasis here. I think we need to send this forward, but put some tentative narrative in a cover type thing with this, and include with it. I would say we need some additional process that we're going to work on. One of the people who is on the Planning Commission and has had tremendous interest in schools and other things for that matter has also given feedback saying, what happened to Leapfrog? Where are we with that? And Leapfrog, for those who don't recall, was an attempt to get at how do we provide for a process that brings the City Council, the Planning Commission, and the School Board together in one space, opportunity to discuss what are these implications of the facilities we're facing, the financial concerns, and how do we skillfully plan for them. And I think we need to talk about a process. If it's not Leapfrog, what is it? How do we get back to that place where we're getting those three bodies to, I would at least say, sort of orchestrate the process. There's probably a way that they collaborate in a three-part type fashion, but then there are individual projects that also need a process that deals with them, or maybe a school by school process. But anyway, it needs kind of a two-level focus. One level is this high level and coordinating, orchestrating level, and then the other one is a more detailed place by place, school by school, whatever you want. I don't think it matters too much how you organize it, but as long as you do it in a sensible way that is more detailed on the lower level. So I think there are a variety of ways that you could do it, and I was terribly impressed with the way that you did organize the ASAC committee to get us through a very, very high quality review of how should we renovate TJ. That's the kind of review which involved the community, it involved the staff, it involved the board. It helped us to get at in a very quick way, but still a very thorough review. So that's the two things I think we need are this. Let's send it forward, but we need a cover that tells people about a two-part process, coordinating at the top level and details at a lower level. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sharp. Dr. Jones, I had one question about this, and I'm looking on the page that's labeled Capital Improvement Plan Draft, Addendum Number 1, Cherry Street Property.
Right.
And we have there three estimates. We have a level 1 code right. minimum estimate, a level 2 code minimum plus,
right.
and on the other page, level 3 complete
right.
gut renovation.
Right.
I know we don't know whether we're going to renovate or rebuild
right.
that, but I do have a question about sending three levels of estimates over with our capital plan rather than saying, this is what we think it will cost. We have had some criticism from City Council in the past that our communications are kind of murky. They can't
right.
tell what it is we really want.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm wondering if the board wants to entertain to send a recommendation for Cherry Street rather than three levels as a part of this plan. I would recommend that, and I certainly wouldn't recommend level 1.
Yeah.
I don't think that meets what we do in our schools here in Falls Church to keep our children safe and healthy. That's my question.
And I will say, because I did the on-site assessments with Luke Meyer and Arcadis, that my recommendation would be level 3 for sure, based on 1 and 2 were just trying to do it at a minimum and not in a way where we would want necessarily to have our pre-K children there.
We could, but...
Well, that kind of answers the
yeah.
question.
I think that answers the question. So the superintendent's recommendation was...
I have them all three on here, yeah.
And I appreciate that. Okay. I appreciate that. So let's move this forward with a level three recommendation then, as what we think is right for our schools and our division.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
All right. Any other questions before we call a motion? Do we have a motion on this?
Madam Chair, I move to approve the CIP draft as amended and discussed this evening.
Thank you, Ms. Wodisca. Second?
I second.
Thank you, Mr. Rasnick. Is there any further discussion or question? Yes.
I just suggest that this is a good faith activity good faith action that we're putting forward here. We've been asked to accelerate our review to a tremendous extent, and with greatly shifting circumstances being presented to us on the fly almost. So I would just say this is we're really putting forth a collaborative show of good faith here, and I hope that it's understood as such, and I hope that others will similarly reach out and reach back to us. Seems like in some instances there's a lot of movement away, a lot of movement toward things that really concern the schools, and yet there's apparently no attempt to even communicate with us. We need to get that collaborative process working two ways. It's not just us having that good faith effort. We need it to come back to us.
Thank you, Mr. Sharp. Anything else? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right. Thank you, Dr. Jones, for that fabulous work. That just was terrific to take a look at. For the community's information, what happens next is this draft CIP goes to the city, to the Planning Commission, and Planning Commission members and staff have the ability to move it, shift it, change it, update it, so it will fit in policy. So we have before sent things over that have gotten changed fairly dramatically in the past, and that could happen here, and then this board will work with City Council past that to ensure we have what we need for our schools. All right, I think the next item on the agenda is 806, which has to do with some policies. Dr. Jones.
Both of these are policies that we're just updating language because they are aspects that we really can do already without having it in policy. We just needed to update. So, and making sure that we are noting in here that Mr. Bird has the flexibility with hybrid learning at the high school to give competency credit without coming and knocking on my door and asking me every time. So all we're really doing is untying their hands to be able to say, you're okay to move forward with hybrid learning. And both of these policies are language-based. Where that's all it is an update to the language for competency-based units.
All right.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I move that the board waive first reading and approve second reading and adoption of policy 6.15, high school credit, 6.35, remedial instruction program through regular school year and summer school.
Second.
All right, any discussion? All right, all in favor, please aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, thank you. That motion passes as well, and we're now ready for the superintendent's report.
Okay, and you've heard enough from me tonight, so I won't be too windy, but for academics, we would like to congratulate Mount Daniel and Thomas Jefferson both for being recognized by the Virginia Department of Education, again, for outstanding, you know, achievement and getting their students where they need to be, so we commend them on that and great leadership there. We are headed into exam time at GM, so they're going to be very, very busy there. Our robotics team is in full swing, and I know they've sent out one or two dates. They encourage people to go and watch them. I believe their first regional is in Richmond. I was out of town for their last one, but I'm going to try to make the next one. We also have some fabulous concerts going on. I was at the MEH Middle School concert last night. There's another one tonight, but I was here. And again, those are our, we have a great music department doing wonderful things, vocally as well as instrumentally. Basketball, wrestling, swimming, and winter cheer seasons are all underway. And again, we, you know, want to say thank you to all of those contributors this year that helped our FCCS children during the winter holidays and Christmas and Hanukkah time, that donated to help a child, whether that was through clothing or toys or gifts, but a huge community outpouring of support for our children. So thank you to the community for that. And that's all for me tonight.
All right, very good. Time for board comments. Starting on my left with Mr. Resnick.
Thank you. I just wanted to make just a quick comment on the budget. You know, as many of you know, I used to have a little bit of work in crafting budgets, and I will tell you that I greatly appreciate this budget. I think it's going to be something that's very easy for the community to digest. I do want to note, with the deft skill of a sledgehammer, how I'm so impressed that you know, on your own, made what I'd call like administrative consolidations and found cost savings there. I know that there has been criticism in the community, and honestly by some people on council, that we're top heavy. I don't, never thought we were. Honestly, I think that our percentage of administrative costs are really fairly low for an organization. But with that said, instead of coming in and doing what might many may call empire building, you did the opposite and found savings within your own executive staff. And I want you to know that I appreciate that. And I hope that the community and especially council will note that. Your budget is driven primarily by basically, you know, record-setting enrollment increases. And this community needs to rally behind this budget. I think you have presented a very responsible budget. I think we need it, and I just want you to know that I'm going to be willing to fight for it. And I thank you, and we look forward to continuing negotiations on this budget as we go forward.
I would just like to thank you too, Dr. Toni Jones, because I really like the way you say, this is two teachers, this is four teachers. It makes it such an easy decision, because you know, when you look at it in that way, that's what it's really all about, our kids. And so I can really tell that you're an advocate for our kids, and I think that's wonderful. Thank you. And just by looking at your budget. And I never thought we were top heavy, though.
Well, thank you. I have two items for the benefit of the public this evening. The first is, yesterday I had the privilege of attending the governor's press conference as he rolled out his education agenda, and that was truly, as always, a delight and an honor to represent all the school board members across Virginia. What I would highlight for the public are two items. The first and foremost is that for the first time in well over almost 30 years, the governor is proposing to back local control over the school calendar. And this is a significant shift for the state. The governor is saying, the state would allow school board members working with their local parents, their local businesses, to decide when it's best to start school. This is called the repeal of the Labor Day Law, or the so-called King's Dominion Law. We would, here in the city of Falls Church, we have held this view for a very long time that we'd like to be able to chart our own fate, to decide our own calendar. And so I yesterday appealed to all state legislators to back the governor, more importantly, back local school board members, and let us decide how to govern our own calendar. But I would really encourage our new local representative, Dick Saslaw, who's our new representative, to represent the city of Falls Church, and to do so with pride, and I would hope and expect his full support on this. It makes sense. The time has come. The King's Dominion Law no longer helps support the economic interests of our state, and the economic interests of a few cannot limit the economic interests of all, and the economic interests of all are frankly those of our children. And so the time has come, and I hope that everyone will back this bill and we can move this forward and get on to the other business of the state. The second thing is next week Monday, I'll be meeting to have the final vote before the governor's task force on local mandates. Earlier this year, I was appointed by the governor to help lead an effort statewide to roll back state red tape on schools. And through outreach to Dr. Jones and her staff and school board members across the state, we were able to identify 129 state mandates on education that could be rolled back in short order, in addition to an additional 75 reports that the state requires our staff to complete, some not once, but twice or three or even four times a year. So next week, Monday, the group, the task force, will vote. We will have an official vote. We will make formal recommendations to the governor on items that should be, must be, repealed this legislative session. Top on that list will be the repeal of the Labor Day law, suspension of the master calendar, and I'm most proud to say we will be asking the governor to compel the state agencies to have a 15% reduction in paperwork on school districts. The more time that our staff spends on paperwork, the less time that they can spend helping kids. And during these times of difficult economic pressures and rising expectations for all of our students to achieve, it is more important than ever that we free up our staff to be able to focus back on people. And so I look forward to having the opportunity to represent our community and all of you and to vote on that, and I'll keep you apprised. And wanted to thank everyone for their hard work. Marty and Hunter and Dr. Jones in particular have done a yeoman's job of helping educate me, as well as the rest of the task force members, about the paperwork burden. And I hope, in turn, that we can do something about that for you.
Thank you. This end of the dais, Ms. Hyland.
Thank you, Ms. Carney. Two meetings that I recently attended included last night the George Mason Athletic Boosters, and we discussed a few of the things that were in your draft, underlined draft, CIP, the turf, the lights, and the track, and so that's issues that have been discussed among the community there at George Mason. Coach Horn brought that up. But another issue that some folks may have read about in the media and has been just mentioned in the past week or so is the proposed changes to the structure in VHSL of the distinctions in the different classes of schools that compete. Currently, there's single A, double A, triple A. George Mason is a single A school, which is the, and it's strictly based on school population, and we are in the smallest category. They're proposing changing it from 3 to 6 designations, so it would be 1 through 6, and the way George Mason would fall would be 2 right now. And this is, it's all very vague. I don't know if you've read any of the articles about it. I have, and I had questions last night for Coach Horn because I didn't quite understand it, and he said it's still quite vague. He was at a meeting about this and said that there's a lot of discussion. It's very difficult to change rules in Virginia because each area has one vote, no matter how many schools are in the different areas. So where we are in Northern Virginia, we have a bigger population, but our vote is the same as any other area, and so it's hard to get things done in terms of just any kind of consensus. But the way it works is VHSL rules changes happen on a 2-year cycle, and we're in the first year, so it wouldn't happen before fall of 2013. And it's done, the proposal is to alleviate the travel distances that so many schools have, and it's also to change the playoff structure. But for us, you know, it would change the Bull Run district, certainly. There are schools that would drop out because of they'd be in the single A. There are schools that would move up into what would be they would move into the lower level of what is currently double A. But it's all sort of, you know, there's a lot of discussion, but it was interesting to hear about. It will change things for us in that we would possibly not travel as far for certain parts of our district, and it's just sort of understood that there's a lot of discussion. So I will keep you guys apprised of that. And last week, the George Mason PTSA had their meeting at the same, they didn't have the regular meeting, they had a program at George Mason with this group called Protect, that is, it's based in Fairfax County, and it's community members and parents, and it's also civic, it's government-based as well, and it sort of overlaps into some parts of Falls Church, which is why we invited them there. I know Mr. Sharp was there, and he probably has more to say about it, but it's to talk about drug and substance abuse in our schools, and the panel that comes and speaks, it varies, I'm sure, from school to school, includes parents of a young woman who died of a drug overdose, and also a young woman who was involved in the same drug ring that this girl was in Chantilly that happened. It was about 4 years ago, and that's what sort of triggered this whole thing. And I think the information that we heard wasn't necessarily new, I think, to anybody, and it wasn't particularly well publicized, I thought, although it was very well attended. There were a lot of people there. There were some students as well as parents. It wasn't just parents who came. Like I said, it wasn't necessarily a lot of new information. It underlined the fact that the assumptions that people make about who you think is going to perhaps have substance problems isn't necessarily true at all. You know, the family of the girl who died of the overdose, this girl, you know, never really participated in any of these types of behaviors in high school. She was really against it. But circumstances change. Things happen that parents don't even see. And I think it was a real interesting message for all of us that we can't assume anything about our kids, and we can't assume that this kind of behavior doesn't happen, you know, right in our backyard. And I think it's really, you know, there was a lot of, they had a lot of handouts and a lot of information. They have a website. I'd be happy to give all of you more information about it. But it was really an important meeting, and I walked out of there, you know, with just a lot of respect for the folks who came and spoke. So I was glad to have attended.
Mr. Sharp?
There is an opportunity this Saturday at the community center, Saturday morning, for a town hall meeting with our legislators, including Mr. Saslaw. and I hope many will come and partake for a variety of issues that I know our community is concerned about, but I hope that we can get some additional support for the change in the calendar control that would be beneficial for our schools and I think throughout the state, as Joan has indicated. I hope we can shift a bit of the emphasis in the budgeting that's out there. I know there's certainly sentiment on Mr. Saslaw's part for that, and also Mr. Scott's, and there are some interesting innovations that Mr. Scott was nice enough to talk with Susan Carney and Hunter Kimball and myself over the holidays. We had a meeting about the legislative package overall, but focusing to some extent on VRS and its very substantial implications for our budget. And he has some interesting ideas about other revenue enhancements that if they were adopted, and it's not just I think you know, the liberal side of the community that's interested in those. I was reading about some proposed changes in Indiana where they're talking about local options for enhanced sales tax or enhanced property tax at the local level. And that's seen actually as a as a conservative idea in some circles. So you know, it doesn't necessarily hew to the party lines that we're used to. The calendar decision, though, I think it's important for us to highlight a bit here. Right before the holidays, we did not go forward with an approved calendar for the 2012-2013 year with the idea that we might want to make some change. No expression yet of exactly what that could be, wisely, I think. But at the same time, we wanted to leave ourselves the opportunity for a discussion and perhaps a change in 2012-2013, taking advantage of this change that the governor is proposing. And I think he's gotten some good advice from the mandate panel and others on why this is a great change that needs to come at this time. So for the benefit of, again, local parents and businesses here, please understand that our calendar is not yet set for the 2012-2013 year, and that we need to talk about what process do we need to go through to get there. I was at the city council meeting last night to receive a proclamation for National Mentoring Month. I was very pleased to learn that despite the great difficulty we've had the last couple of years with budgeting, that in fact, at the moment, our community enjoys a three-level programming of mentoring that's available for our students. The first level is what's called a 1-2-1 mentoring program for middle schoolers. It meets at the community center on Thursday afternoons. It has a quarterly cycle that it goes through. So every quarter, including the quarter that we're entering right now, there is a renewed emphasis on new students and new mentors. And if any of you are interested as mentors, certainly, but also if you happen to have a middle schooler who maybe has been doing some things you don't think are quite the way they're supposed to be at the moment, this is a program you should look into. A social worker from Northern Virginia Family Service will come out to the home to meet with the parent and the student, and it's all voluntary. They'll make an assessment whether this could be helpful to the student, and then there is a staff member from that group who will be monitoring the mentoring as it goes on at the community center and helping that entire process work well. The second level is that because we've had more than a year in this middle school programming, there are now people who have gone into high school and they are continuing with a mentor in high school, and that mentoring is taking place, can take place at locations other than the community center. It's the same mentor, the same student, so it's an established relationship, and now that plan for meeting between those can occur at other places in the community. The last level is a new level that's being just in the proposal stage. It's for court-involved students and those that have difficulty for one reason or another with the court system, whether it's through Aurora House, which is right here in our own community, or for other reasons, students get involved with the juvenile court. There is a plan to develop a mentoring program just for those students. That's a really exciting development. It does take money. There will be a request to the City Council to sustain the funding that's currently there and to assist with additional funding for the court-involved students. So that's something that I think is an important but collateral aspect to the kind of budgeting that we're talking about. And I'll just say that in the community itself, some of this is driven by nonprofit funding and private funding. So I'm one of those who helps to raise funds for the mentoring effort throughout Northern Virginia. If you know of some businesses or individuals who have an interest in this area, please get them in touch with me or with the Partnership for Youth, www.fairfaxyouth.org. There are a number of nonprofits still in this business. That the number has shrunk from where it was in 07, from about 25 of those nonprofits that were in the mentoring business at that time. Now it's a fewer than 10 because of the recession. So funding is critical in this area. But thank you to all those who have helped to continue that funding to be in place, including in our own community where we've expanded our mentoring program rather than seen it contract during this time. Lastly, I'll just say, Charlotte, thank you for attending that session at George Mason High School, and all those who did attend, I think, benefited from the awareness, the very keen insight that those panelists were able to provide. I'll just say, I think they helped us understand the lifelong implications of these issues, the life-threatening implications of them. And I think they, as this process moves forward, they could help us understand the global implications of those issues, because it isn't just a problem for us here in Northern Virginia. It's a problem throughout this hemisphere. There are 30-some thousand deaths that have occurred in Mexico just in the last 5 years as a result of the trafficking of drugs into the United States. And to say that it's only our kids who are hurt by the activity that's going on in the drug area is a gross understatement. There are many, many others who are hurt by it. And I think our kids need to understand that. I think our parents need to. I think our communities need to. So thanks very much.
All right, Mr. Sharp, I have a few things, and I'm going to try to be as brief as I can with them. First, just a final thanks to Dr. Toni Jones for her presentations this evening on the budget. Just professional and great work. So looking forward to working through that process kind of in the next few months. Kind of. A second, I want to congratulate our own athletic director, Coach Tom Horn. It was a pleasure to see him named in the Washington Post story on the VHSL realignment as chairman of the group that is discussing that. He's terrific for our school, and it's nice to see the leaders of a small school division like ours on the statewide stage. So congratulations to him. He's just absolutely terrific. Third, thanks to Delegate Scott for spending time with myself and Mr. Kimball and my colleague, Karen Sharp, over the holidays, taking time out of his schedule and family time to talk with us, to listen one-on-one to us about the concerns our jurisdiction, and particularly our school board, have about the upcoming General Assembly, and specifically about the calendar, and especially VRS, and the challenges that we're going to have as a division and other divisions will have in funding that particular part of the budget. Speaking of the budget, I want my colleagues to know that I will begin working with the principals to see if we can find time for our annual school board visits to the schools. We go each year to every school to listen to the staff tell us about their budget issues, concerns, and ask questions. And if other folks want to attend those, if you'll just let me know, then I'll make sure that you know when those are taking place as I arrange those. My hope is to arrange them sometime between the 21st and our second budget session, which is, I think, on the 6th or 7th of February, so that we have that feedback going into our second work session, which is where we really kind of roll up our sleeves and get a lot done. Well, the 21st is when we have our first budget session. In January.
That
is a Saturday. I have it off too, kind of.
That Monday.
Okay. I'll see what I can set up. Thank you, Rosara. The Special Ed Advisory Committee had its meeting last evening, its monthly meeting for this month. By way of informing my colleagues, there was a lot of discussion during the course of that meeting about resources that we have to attend to special needs where there we have a small number of children who have that need, and whether during our budget deliberations, which is why I bring it up this evening, we need to be looking at more flexible ways to get access to part-time, outsourced, consulting, partnered, or shared resources to give the best services possible to our children that have special needs when we don't have someone with that expertise here. I wanted to pass that along to you for your thought as we go into the budget process. And finally, the Daycare Advisory Board will hold its monthly meeting tomorrow night, 7:30 p.m. 7:30? I always get that wrong. So 4 years I've been doing this. 7 o'clock at the daycare trailer at TJ tomorrow night for those parents who might want to come for public comment or simply to listen to what topics. I don't know what's on the agenda yet. I haven't seen that from Michael, but that'll be tomorrow night. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. And we're in the final stretch for this evening. We have two sets of minutes, and it looks to me like we can do them all at one time.
Madam Chair?
Yeah.
I'd like to, just want to note for the record that when Joan makes her run for governor, and I'll be the first person to sign up to support her, she has lost any chance at getting money from the King's Dominion PAC.
King PAC.
So that being said, Madam Chair, I'd like to the school board to approve the minutes of December 6th and December 13th, 2011.
Thank you. All in favor of that, please say
aye.
Aye. Ayes have it. Thank you very much. Dr. Jones, if you will very quickly tell us about the important things in the board review materials, and we will then adjourn. Board materials.
Oh, let me switch to that because I was bringing up the email that John Brett had created.
Never mind. So we have a few materials for board review here, including, importantly, the City Council's November financial report for those of you who want to see what's happening in terms of city finances, our enrollment census that we get each month, and some IB diploma information, as well as, probably thanks to Kieran, the JLARC report on the review of retirement benefits for our employees here in the state. With that, we're adjourned.
Thank you. Can you proof this and see if that's what you want?
This is nice. Yeah. I don't have to, like, you know, hurt myself this year carrying a book binder. Yeah. It's nice.
Yeah, it's thinner than usually.
It's thinner. It's very same information, but, so, you know.
Enter works very hard.